To Write or Not to Write by Susan Andrews Rice From the Writer Volume 6 April 1892 This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. To Write or Not to Write. When anyone living in this age of the world feels that he has thoughts clamoring for utterance, he seeks advice from someone who has attained success in the profession of literature. In most instances, he receives no satisfactory criticism, and is compelled to act on innate conviction of his right to enter the thorny path and fight his way up to the top, where, we are told, there is always room. There seem to be two literary factions pitted against each other. Those of one class employ their best effort in dissuading young writers from writing. Those of another set forth an author's life in glowing colors. One faction will tell you that half the manuscripts sent to editors are not even accorded the courtesy of an examination, unless signed by a well-known name. Another says that editors are keenly on the outlook for original matter, seizing with avidity anything that promises to make a new element in current literature. A noted author writes to a young aspirant, "Sweet and natural though your utterance seems to be, let me ask you in the friendliest spirit not to write at all. The toil is great, the pursuit incessant, the reward not outward." To the same young woman writes another equally well-known writer, "Your work is excellent. You can and will succeed." The fact is obvious that there is a literary aristocracy in America, born in an intellectual atmosphere, with inherited talent, wrapped in their own dreams, knowing little of the struggle and toil of their less fortunate co-workers. Its members stand aloof, saying, "Thou shalt not enter here." The old Italian poet quaintly puts it, "For singing loudly is not singing well, but ever by the song that soft and low the master singer's voice is plain to tell." Few have it, and yet all are masters now, and each of them can trill out what he calls his ballads, canzonets, and madrigals. The world with masters is so covered o'er, there is no room for pupils any more. Therefore, the individual who contemplates becoming an author must be a law unto himself. If he finds his truest expression, his greatest delight in literary work, let him persevere, all the world to the contrary, notwithstanding. There is no chance, no destiny, no fate can circumvent, can hinder, or control the firm resolve of a determined soul. Gifts count for nothing. Will alone is great. An editor, noted for his gentleness and courtesy, tells us that all writers must go through an evolutionary process of rejected manuscripts, and cites the instance of Mrs. Harriet Prescott Spofford, who awoke one morning to find herself famous. She had written The Amber Gods, when congratulated as the first author who had attained reputation by a single effort. She replied, "No, that is not true. I have been writing for years under an assumed name." End of To Write or Not to Write by Susan Andrews Rice. Read by Craig Campbell in Appleton, Wisconsin in 2009.